Individuals with extraordinary abilities may already be among us.
MacTaggert, you really think that some crackpot scientist is going to make me believe in sparkly dames and vanishing men?
I didn't really expect you to believe me. One of the many spectacular things my mutation allows me to do is that I can read your mind.
Are you going to ask us to think of a number between 1 and 10 now?
No, Agent Stryker, although I could ask you about the Jupiter missiles America are currently placing in Turkey.
You brought a damn spy into this facility!
How's that for a magic trick?
Best I've ever seen.
Do you expect me to talk?
Hello, everybody, and welcome to episode 215 of Do You Expect Us to Talk? I'm Becca, and as always, joined by my fellow co-hosts, Chris and Dave. How are you both?
Good evening, folks.
Feeling excellent. Thank you.
Are you feeling classy?
Yes, you could say it's I'm feeling first place. There you are.
Yeah.
Any puns you can offer there, Dave?
I don't know. Someone about me coming first, probably.
Men come first.
Yeah.
Women. Oh well.
Yes. I feel a little bit happier about what we've covered this week than the last two.
Let's put this is one of the high points in the series.
Yeah. It's in fact I don't know till we get to Logan, but certainly it's in first place at the moment. I need to give Logan another watch because I've only actually seen Logan once, I think. And had positive yet mixed feelings about it at the same time. But we will come to those in a few weeks. But I genuinely can see why people like that film, but really didn't have the same sort of emotional reaction to it as some. So I'll be interested to see how I get on with that on a rewatch with no expectations. My feeling ever since Logan and through the last two or three they've done as well that and in fact, right the way back to 2011, is this was probably my favourite X-Men film. And I see no reason to go against that yet. I'll come into onto first thoughts in a bit. In terms of... well, actually, you best introduce it first, Becca. Who's in it?
So, yes, we are reviewing X-Men First Class, starring James McAvoy, Michael Fassbender, January Jones, Kevin Bacon, Nicholas Holt, Jennifer Lawrence, Rose Byrne, Zoe Kravitz, Jason Fleming... and Luca Pistol from Casino Royale, with original music by Henry Jackman.
Who from Casino Royale?
Luca Pistol, I can't pronounce his name. Basically, the Swiss banker.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
What, he goes, hello.
What, the one who could have been... The one that could have been played by David Walliams.
Probably, yeah.
Yeah, okay.
It's just a shame he didn't bring any chocolates with him, that's all.
No. or the pin code for... millions and millions of stacks of cash. Yes, with original score by Henry Jackman, scripts by Ashley Miller, Zach Stentz, Jay Goldman, aka Mrs. Jonathan Ross, and Matthew Vaughn, directed by Matthew Vaughn, and released 2011.
Yeah, I saw this in Canada. I was just literally on a way on holiday and still managed to go to the cinema about three times while I was there. I'm trying to think what the other films I saw were now. I can't really... it will come back to me, but I can't remember now. I watched this near Toronto. And I wasn't expecting too much from it, because it had been... I mean, not counting X-Men Origins, it was the first sort of full X-Men film in about 5 years. Not much good regard for the third one. And Matthew Vaughn at this point really... I don't think I'd even seen Layer Cake at this point. It took me a long time to see Layer Cake. So, looking back at his career, I'd seen Kick-Ass and that was it. And Kick-Ass is a film I don't like as much as most people do. I always thought Kick-Ass was okay. it was talked about like it was this groundbreaking comedy and, you know, really hilariously deconstructing superhero films, and I thought it was just fine. And Kick-Ass 2 I thought was fucking unbearable. So, I mean, it wasn't until this and then the first of the Kingsman films that I actually thought this guy had anything to offer, with the caveat I didn't see Layer Cake until, you know, the last year or two. So I had very little... I mean, even on the writing team, I saw Jane Goldman was involved. I knew Jane Goldman was Jonathan Ross's wife because he refers to her quite a lot. And I know she'd written Kick-Ass, and Kick-Ass was fairly sharp. But again, I think the problem with Kick-Ass is Nick Cage is the guy in the first one. And I don't really like Nick Cage. And in the second one, it's fucking... what's he called?
Jim Carrey.
And I don't like him either. I wanted to like it more than I did, because I like the idea. And not only that, it pissed the Daily Mail off, which always makes me laugh. The Daily Mail...
that's always good value.
Well, they were complaining about the sexualization of what she calls character.
Yeah.
Which is just horseshit. There is nothing sexualized about her whatsoever. They're not trying to make that a sexual character in any way, and I just thought that there they are just trying to whip up fucking conservative outrage again. So I went in really wanting to like it, and I didn't. I just thought it was okay. And if you gave me on like a stick, a download, or a USB or a disc or something at the moment, Kick-Ass, I wouldn't watch it. I've got no interest in reviewing it. And so that's all I knew of sort of Jane Goldman, although I knew she'd, you know, appeared on a few things and written for a few things.
She did Stardust as well.
That
was a really good film.
But then I've not seen Stardust. I still haven't seen Stardust.
You can see it and read the book as well.
And then you've got the screenwriter was Ashley Miller, was known for Agent Cody Banks, which I've never seen. Thor, which I didn't think was very good, and probably wouldn't have been long out until I saw this. And then there's a load of like TV. Zach Stentz, much the same thing. They obviously come as a pair. The only thing half decent they've written for, apart from this, is the Sarah Connor Chronicles, which I thought was quite promising until the writer's strike actually sort of killed that series, in much the same way it did Heroes, or at least it destroyed the quality. He's gone on to sort of stay a bit of a producer with that. I mean, the score's very good. That stuck out to me today. So Henry Jackman, we know, has quite a track record for decent scores. And again, I think I'm right in saying I knew his name back when this came out, but I can't think what for specifically. And he's gone on to do consistently good work ever since. The cinematographer, again, nothing really stood out, with the exception, and it's a big exception, of Gladiator, really. So, yeah, I went in with relatively low expectations. I think I was also a little bit stung, philosophically, really, I suppose, by the Star Wars prequels. I was always open to the idea of a prequel. And then I went through three Star Wars prequels, which, even if they'd been well written, had no fucking tension whatsoever, because we just know it's going to end up with some guy in a suit who's evil, you know? So,
plot twist.
So I think, broadly speaking, what I'm saying is Matthew Vaughn as a name I just associated with Guy Ritchie. Guy Ritchie's not a director I have a great lot of time for. I certainly don't have a lot of time for this fucking Cockney hard boy bollocks. That stuff has always pissed me off, you know. So I really don't like any of that. Plus, you know, he's been known to cast Vinnie Jones, which is just a no-no. I mean, Lockstock. Everyone raved about Lockstock. And whilst I found Snatch quite funny, I really didn't like Lockstock. I just thought it was a terrible film.
He was in one of the previous X-Men movies, wasn't he?
I'm
Juggernaut, bitch.
So, yeah, what I'm saying is the director had less pedigree for me now then than he does now. So I went into this with very low expectations. What about you guys?
Becca, do you
want to
go first?
You can go first this time.
Okay, yeah, I mean, I'm kind of similar to with Dave, relatively, in terms of like the series, because I think this was kind of like a pleasant surprise. I liked Matthew Vaughn, I saw Layer Cake at the cinema, and I enjoyed that, and came out with Stardust, which was something that would seem random. It's not something I would normally go to, like, you know, go to watch or something. So I did, for whatever reason, I went and saw it, and I walked away. I actually really, really enjoyed that as well. So I was quite pleasantly surprised by Matthew. So I was quite interested by what he came out with. Was Kick-Ass was before this? Was it?
Yeah, Kick-Ass was 2010.
Yeah.
Like I say, I think just to quickly clarify, I didn't dislike Kick that film, but it is talked about it was genre defining, and I heard podcasts where I respect that podcast to this day, and someone said, "Oh, I've got a new favorite movie," and I'm thinking, I just saw nothing in it to grab that sort of reaction.
Which podcast was that?
That was a Slash Filmcast, although the presenter who said that left that show about 8 years ago, so it's none of the current team.
So I do like Kick-Ass, so I've not actually seen it for a good while. It's probably something I probably will rewatch in a bit in the near future. However, I kind of see and probably agree with you that, you know, the hype machine does just overhype things too much, and you know it's like everyone's like everyone's favorite thing, you know. It's flavor of the week, and whether it's actually worthy of it or not, it's kind of like
Deadpool. I would liken it to the reaction to Deadpool. But what I would say is, whilst I don't rate Deadpool as high as some people, I would say the first Deadpool is unquestionably a better film than Kick-Ass. I think the first Deadpool gave me one absolutely brilliant first watch. I didn't like it on second watch very much, and I didn't really like the sequel. I really only had like one Deadpool film in me, but Deadpool at least gave me one great viewing. Kick-Ass was always like, what's the fucking fuss about? It's all right. Oh, what, a 10-year-old's fucking swearing? Is that what you're getting excited about?
Yeah, I mean...
And also Super had come out before it.
Well,
is the same fucking concept, and yet they're all wanking off about what an amazing idea. So it was done 4 years ago.
Well, yeah, I mean that was kind of like some of the hipsters were saying that. Well, you know,
they loved it.
I never really got on with Superbad. Something about Superbad just like sort of a bit too. I don't know. It was just a bit too much and a bit uneven. A bit. I don't know. It just felt a bit like.
It had two funny jokes in it. One was McLovin, which was, like, undoubtedly funny. And the second one is a bit grim, but it was funny when he got period blood on his legs. And apart from that, the film is not fucking funny.
It's super bad, isn't
you
it?
You said super bad. I thought you were just talking...
Sorry.
Well, I thought you were talking about the genre in general.
No, what's that film? What was that film again? Was it Super?
Super, yeah, with Ray Wilson.
Yes. Yeah, sorry, that's what I meant, sorry.
That was a different film altogether.
And apropos of nothing, I agreed by saying period blood on a bloke in a different film was funny.
Yeah, Dave was wondering, like, why the hell is he talking about Super?
I went with it, though. I thought he's got a point. I'll go along with it.
I mean, he's not wrong, but, yeah, no, I couldn't really get on with Super as much as Kick-Ass, though.
It's not even about whether it's any good. It's about the fact that I think, like...
Yeah, yeah.
This isn't Matthew Vaughn, by the way. Matthew Vaughn didn't claim he'd fucking redefine cinema or anything. It's just some of the critical reaction to it seemed to forget that it wasn't a new thing, much like Birdman and the faux one take. It's like, yeah, we have seen this done, you know.
Yeah, I mean, it's almost like, you know, like sort of critics and the, you know, cinema lovies have their favourites, you know, and so it's like flavour of the week, and as much as they like to big up something, they also like to take something down, and I'm thinking notably Warcraft, which just got like completely unfairly attacked.
I think they looked at the first few screenshots of it and decided it was dead on arrival.
Yeah, it was just amazing to me how, like, that was, like, the general consensus straight out of the gate. And I was like, what the hell are you talking... You know, like, it just seemed to be extremely odd because it was nowhere near... And you can kind of tell because when they all start saying the same thing. And you think, right, there's not really much of a very different opinion here. It's not very nuanced.
Well, this is why, like... I never read a review until I've seen a fucking film. Because I don't know how much... proper critics, because I'm not a proper critic, I do it as a hobby, but I don't know how much people, proper critics, talk to each other at like screenings or WhatsApp or groups or whatever, but you do see a lot of buzz phrases coming out very similar. And I mean, we've all done it. You will do it by coincidence now and again. You'll notice a similarity to a film or something about a theme in a film will make you think of something. And then, funnily enough, you will read that in a review. But I know unconscious plagiarism is so easy to do, particularly if you read a review that does absolutely mirror what you thought. You will end up, if you're not careful, just pinching stuff from it.
You know what it just reminded me of? Mm. And it kind of pissed me off. And it's nothing to do with the film itself. Mm. But Shaun of the Dead, when that film came out, I mean, obviously everyone was jizzing over it. And rightly so, it is a good film.
Oh, it was brilliant.
You know? But again, like you say, it was another thing. But that term, like, rom-com, I thought, that's god awful.
That's terrible, wasn't it? It was cringeworthy.
And I was like, it really sort of lead into the fact that, like, you know, it's a comedy, you know, and it's got zombies in, but it's also like romantic. It's like a romantic comedy. It's like, it's not really though, is it? You know, do you know what I mean? It's not really like a romantic comedy. It just felt way too gimmicky.
I frankly. Because we all get it wrong, and sometimes you write things in a hurry or whatever as well. If I'd written that and it had gone live, I'd be cringing the next day reading it back. I wouldn't rule out writing something that fucking bad.
They probably look at it now and think...
But I would look back at it the next day and go, oh my God, because it is terrible.
Yeah, but when you're just flying off the seat of your pants just for, like, you know, just get the wheels
moving. I'm sure I've written things factually inaccurate, a bit cheesy, wrong. I probably repeat certain phrases as well. But if I'd written that, I'd be really embarrassed the next day because I just think, like, you're either funny or you're not. If you're straining and trying to be funny, then you're not. It's as simple as that. It either comes to you or it doesn't, and that's somebody trying too hard.
But, yeah, but that was a term that constantly get thrown about. And also, not just, like... It was everywhere, and everyone was saying it. It's like, oh, God's sake. Mm. Anyway, that's enough for that. Matthew Vaughn, I quite enjoyed Kick-Ass, even though I kind of see Dave's point about it, the over-hypothesization. So it was kind of, I was looking forward to it, but also with my expectations kind of lowered, just because of, like, you know, X-Men just felt like a dumb thing. Going back doing a prequel isn't usually the typical thing. Usually expect this thing to be like, oh, they tried a prequel, didn't quite work out, but, you know, it might be worth something. Particularly when, like, it was all done in the rush as well. It was all like
11 months. Yeah.
Yeah.
I think what I was going to ask, just as a point of discussion, is can we think of any truly great prequels now? Technically, I don't love Temple of Doom, but Temple of Doom is technically a prequel, but that just seems to be to get around the fact that Marion's the one he's meant to be with and all the rest of it. And it's a year earlier, it's in the same era, so I'm not counting that. I'm talking about where you take an established property, known characters, and do, like, younger versions of them. Has that ever really worked?
Star Trek. Star Wars movies.
No, it didn't work in Star Wars at all. The prequels were god-awful.
Exactly.
And even technically, the reboot of Star Trek wasn't a prequel because it went into a fresh timeline. This sort of does a couple of entries on from now, but this is at this point meant to be Patrick Stewart and Ian McKellen, the early years.
Mm. Would you say this is almost like an alternate one itself, though? Because there were certain things I thought, you know, I'm not quite sure that quite fits in, you know, like, you know, particularly with, like, Mystique being
Charles' old mate when they had absolutely nothing, even implicit between them in the first.
Yeah,
trilogy.
That sounded. Yeah, yeah. It was a little bit like.
And given how Mystique is, like, she is like a stone cold bitch essentially. She, you know,
well, not
like,
only that, I mean, she's killer. She sabotaged. What's it called? Cerebro in the second film and nearly killed him.
Exactly.
So
yeah, just give a bit of a leap of faith.
No, right. They've shat on their timeline all along, but in the strictest possible sense, this is a pure prequel. It's Days of Future Past that will start playing with that. So you saw it at the time, Chris?
Yeah, and I walked away really sort of generally pleasantly surprised. I mean, I had a few gripes, which I will reiterate in the initial review. But apart from that, I walked away kind of, yeah, I solidly enjoyed it. It took me by surprise. I was like, yeah, that's pretty good. I think when I walked away, I tweeted X-Men First Class is aptly named. I think that's probably
because my the X-Men name. Are in it.
Yes. And it is first class. The quality is first class. Yeah. So.
Yeah, I'd be hard pressed to argue this isn't one of the better X-Men films. Yeah. I just think it depends who you are, how many you think are in that good group, and your favourite might vary. I can't really argue with someone who says
it's my favourite as well.
It's my favourite, but I can't. I have to rewatch Logan, but I remember some of the debate we've had about Kick-Ass is how I felt about Logan. I thought it was a vastly overpraised film, but I thought it was a very good film at the same time. It's just, it's talked about like it's a Dark Knight, and for me, it's absolutely nowhere near, but it was a brave and very, very good film. It had some very good bits to it. I think if someone said they prefer that or prefer X2, I wouldn't have an argument, because the three of them are tonally so different to each other that you could just be coming down to preference at that point. Mm. I think on quality, those three films are the elite three. I've heard people argue Days of Future Past. Well, I need to rewatch it yet, and I'll engage that argument in a couple of weeks' time if I view it the same way I viewed it last time. I do enjoy Days of Future Past, but I enjoy it in the same way that I enjoy like the first X-Men film. I think there's stuff wrong with it, but I like it. But I don't think it's as well written as this is. And Becca, did you see it at the time?
I saw it upon release.
Can I ask a sub question? Because you're the big X-Men fan of the three of us. What was your feelings towards the franchise around this point after a couple of poor entries?
My hopes weren't high, really, to be honest. But I think I went and saw this one just on the strength of the cast alone, just going on their previous work, especially Michael Fassbender as well. Especially because he was very much kind of on the rise.
Wasn't it?
He was pretty much in most things, and obviously
he's mostly in Alicia Vikander.
I was going to say another getting it on.
No, he's married to her now.
Yeah, no, very lovely. They are two, definitely. But yeah, he was pretty much on, well, up and up and up, shall we say? And then I remember after this, there was a huge. Obviously, there's that scene where you get, you must have hand down the Nazis to a bar in Portugal, wherever it is they've gone to. No.
And the Bond fan in you came racing to the surface.
It really did. It's like, oh. But no, certainly in the Bond community as well, there is all kinds of, just he should be cast as Bond and he looks really great. And if they were to go back, if Tarantino was to go back and make his 1960s, period setting Bond movie, they should cast Fassbender and all the rest of it. That was just all, all us Bond fans were foaming at the mouth, quite frankly.
Unfortunately, he is now too old to start a run.
What a shame. Oh, dear.
I think we've had this conversation before. If you ask me now, with a current actor, and it can't be Daniel Craig, to, fantasy cast one film to come out this year, I'd pick him. But he's too old to start a run. He's like, 44 now.
Yeah, if they're doing a one-off,
yeah,
I reckon they could do it. But
because in age, he's like a mid-career Bond actor, if you like. Mm. But
Osman was 42 when he started.
Yeah, and I think that's pushing it already. Because Brosnan aged quite
quickly.
I don't
know why I keep on giving him as an example.
No, but I mean, I had no problem with Brosnan. He looked good for three entries, but suddenly he didn't look so good in Die Another Day. No, Roger Moore looked pretty decent for three entries and then just looked too old. I watched half of Octopussy last night because I'm doing the rewatch, and I'm not going to go into Octopussy again, but just on his age, my partner who I'm watching with, she goes, God, he looks so old. She'd never seen it before. And of course, 4 weeks ago, she was watching Live and Let Die. She couldn't believe it.
It's not the same man.
And I just said, well, next week he'll have had a bit of cosmetic surgery. That little bump by his nose will have gone.
He'll have a mole removed.
Because I'm one of the few people who thinks he looks better in the last film than the penultimate film. But he's too old for both of them. So, yeah, I would hesitate about the wisdom. I mean, people, oh, you've got to be Tom Hardy. And it's like, if you haven't thought about it and you like the idea of Tom Hardy, I'm not going to argue. He wouldn't be my choice. I think he's too short as well for a start. But
making it taller?
Yeah, but I just think
he can act in a geological sinkhole.
I know, but everyone goes, well, Craig's only 5'10", and I'm like, yeah, but he's an outlier. How far do you go? They can't just keep getting shorter every time, otherwise Chris will be fucking the next Bond.
They'll cost me.
not fucking the next Bond, the next fucking Bond. I just think, like, you go 6 foot and over, generally speaking, and
then if you
get an absolutely outstanding outlier once every couple of generations, then maybe. But, I mean, Tom Hardy was born in, what, 77? So was Fassbender. They are too old. If the next film comes out even relatively quickly, they're going to be, like, 47 on debut. Too old. But there's no doubt, when he made this, he would have been 33 for most of shooting. And I just totally... If they'd been sort of starting a new Bond that year, he would have been perfect, wouldn't he?
Yeah. Because So especially in the first half, there was definitely like kind of that cool, especially in the 60s era, you're going to get that really cool kind of sort of spy kind of fight, you know, because he's a man on revenge as well. Yeah. And also
in the second half, he does go more Irish, and I have no idea why that happened. Not that I'd have a problem with an Irish Bond, but it's like... He's been cast for this to be like a younger Ian McKellen, so fairly well spoken English, and then suddenly, oh, all right, you've forgotten how to do that, haven't you?
Mutants of the world unite.
Yeah. So no, I mean, the casting was very good. I think the eyebrow raiser, I think there were two pieces of sort of all. See, I don't know if I'm retroactively forgetting that Jennifer Lawrence wasn't at the peak of her fame by this point.
This was just before Hunger Games.
Yeah, because I think of her as almost... I mean, certainly after the...
Yeah, I was going to say, it was after, just literally after just like that, on the
crest. She was definitely on my radar because she was in
Winter's Bone. And then, Winter's Bone was her big break.
That sort of launched her, really. And she was in... Hunger Games came along and that catapulted her into superstardom.
And she was in the two other films I saw, and she was in like Mel Gibson film directed by Jodie Foster, The Beaver.
Yeah.
And the... something with I'm going to butcher his name, but he sadly passed away. The Anton
Yelchin from
Anton Yelchin.
Yeah, from
But
a film with him in with I think it was oh god, her name's fallen out of my head as well.
Come back to it.
Yeah.
She was in leading in Star Wars Rebel One.
Oh, Felicity, whatever she said. Yes. I nearly said Felicity Montague, but that's Lynn from the Alan Partridge universe.
So, yes.
It's Alan Partridge.
God, we're doing well tonight.
All the names
are falling out of my head. It's very hot in the UK, everybody.
But what we'll say is, like, so she wasn't, like, a big name, but she was, like, on the rise. And every time I saw her, she had presence. She's like, you know, she did stand out to you.
She does stand out.
Yeah, she's really good, isn't she? I think she's whatever she does, she's one of these actors, you know, I really rate her, basically, and, like, whatever she's in it, she could be in, like, the worst film ever, and she would improve it with a performance.
She will be in a couple of weeks.
Well, yeah, coming soon, coming soon.
Yeah.
That, no, I mean, like, you know, movie 43, bad.
Yeah.
She could be in it, but it'd be improved just by her being in it.
I think what I would say about Jennifer Lawrence's presence here is in this film, she does the whole Rebecca Romijn thing of, like, completely naked but for prosthetics. Now, if you're wearing prosthetics and they cover your primary and secondary sexual organs, then as far as I'm concerned, you're not naked. But it is sort of classed as that, and also it's quite an exposing role. And as the film goes on...
Hang
on a minute.
12.
As this film goes on, I'm not asking for her to be naked, Becca. I'm saying that they talk about...
It's a 12.
No, listen a minute. I'm saying it's not about wanting her naked. It's about a young actress being in a role that's supposedly quote unquote naked, as though I would argue that really isn't.
She's not technically.
Right, but they always say, "Oh, it's a naked role," and then I think, well, Jennifer Lawrence probably would not do that now, and if she did, she wouldn't walk around the whole film like it. And certainly as this series goes on, she wears the makeup less and less. And even when she is in the full Mystique look, she's wearing clothes, so she doesn't have to wear the full body makeup. So as she got more famous, she had the clout to not do what she did in this film. So going back to this film, I'm not calling her a prima donna because she may have done it very respectfully in conversations with directors and producers and stuff. I've got no evidence. She's just gone, nope. But she's in it less and less as we go on. So coming back to this, the casting seems odd because you can't imagine her now doing a role like this, like fresh from new, going, yes, I'll do that role. And I think I'd always like James McAvoy and still do. I think some of his better performances actually came after this, particularly Split. But he's got to fill that sonorous voice of like Patrick Stewart, and I can't see him as a younger version. Whereas Fassbender, to some degree, yes.
Yeah, I thought it was actually quite well cast, because I don't think the problem with like getting a young Patrick Stewart is there's no young Patrick Stewarts. Yeah. So you kind of have to, like, you know, go outside the box and just go with it, and it's kind of hard because what he's kind of doing is like he's kind of doing how like a Patrick Stewart but as a younger man, as someone who is like who is well educated and can read minds. It's kind of odd because sometimes I always think like he sounds a bit like Paul McKenna, like I can read your mind, that kind of thing. But I think he actually does a good job because I can actually sort of see, you know, if I can picture Patrick Stewart or like a young Charles Xavier, this is kind of how I can kind of believe him to be like, as like a, yeah, he's a bit, you know, he's, you know, he likes to chat lays a bit, but he's also like, you know, quite intelligent and quite sort of like, especially in his attitude as well and his philosophy, you know, with which we'll get into in terms of Erik, because he sort of like he kind of appreciates, you know, the broader things, you know, he sees things like as a whole.
Yeah.
You know, so he's like, he's telling Erik, you're focused more on hate and anger, whereas like there's other extremes, there's like, you know, there's beauty in there, and he's like, when he picks a thing about his mother, he's like, that's a beautiful thought, thank you, you know. So he's very, even though he's like, he's just reading people's minds like all the fucking time, which is kind of unethical, but you know, he's like, oh my god, that's amazing, this is amazing. So I do buy it in a sense, and I think, you know, I think, but I don't think
it's a complaint. I don't think it's a complaint.
No.
I really like him in the role.
It's hard because there's no young Patrick Stewart.
I'm just going on announcement. When it was announced, yeah. I was thinking of him in like Starter for 10 and stuff, and I'm like,
yeah,
as Patrick Stewart, really? But there you go. Patrick Stewart, it doesn't help Patrick Stewart has looked, I mean, he is aging. We talked about that a couple of weeks ago, and he's aging quite a lot, but he still looks fundamentally similar to when he was in his 40s, just an older version, obviously balded young and things like that. But so, but yeah, but it all worked out for the best. Rose Byrne, I can't remember what I'd seen her in by this point, but I certainly recognized her as an actress at this time and always had quite a lot of time for her. Obviously we get Kevin Bacon very early. I've always liked him. I'm just going back through Rose Byrne's. Yeah, she'd already done Bridesmaids by this point. Getting to the Greek. 28 weeks later, I'm thinking of things I've seen rather than everything.
Oh, right.
She was in Sunshine. Troy. Oh, yeah, I remember her in Troy now. Not thought of that in years, but I do remember it. And, of course, she was Padme's double in Attack of the Clones. I failed you. No, you just did your job. Nicholas Holt, I think this was the first time I'd seen her since About a Boy. So I saw him as a grown up for the first time. Jandy Ree Jones I'd had a crush on since American Wedding. And Zoe Kravitz at this point was daughter of Lenny Kravitz and Lisa Bonet. You know what I mean? She'd yet to really start her, sort of set out her own sort of career. But obviously since then, she's been very successful. I think that's all I want to say on sort of background to it. I'll just whip into opening thoughts, but I've largely covered it. This is my favourite X-Men film to date. By to date, I mean to date, as in now before the MCU doing it. But I mean more specifically in this rewatch, because, like I say, watch everything with an open mind, and there's at least one film to come I might end up preferring. I just love the style to it. I love the musical style. I love it feeling a period piece and fairly new at the same time. It takes something, you know, the 60s have suddenly, you know, not suddenly, but over the years become a bit cool again, and they really grasp that here. And Matthew Vaughn's perfect for it, and when you see him go on and do things like Kingsman, he is quite an impressive visual stylist. The new cast are great. Obviously, Jennifer Lawrence was very young at this point, so again, seeing her as Mystique was odd, and it's still odd because she's so famous now. But I can't argue that she's anything other than good in the role. Both our main male leads are terrific. I think Nicholas Holt plays it really sort of internal and very different from... He doesn't really sell as a young Kelsey Grammer, but you don't need him to. It's amazing how much range he's got. He was an awkward kid in About a Boy. He's kind of an awkward teenager here. But then you go and see him in something like The Favourite as a right sort of scoundrel, I suppose they would call him in the vernacular of that era, and he really is. And he only just lost out to Pattinson for the Batman role. So he's an actor to watch. He can do a bit of everything. So, yeah, I really enjoyed it. I'll have some issues as we go through. I've always had a problem with this series continuity. Because it's a reboot and a new cast, I can switch it off a little bit and watch it as self-contained. But there will be things where it bothered me on the way through it, and I'm sure they'll bother me as we talk our way through it. But apart from that, it's really, really enjoyable, and it stands comparison with the best origin films out there anyway.
Yeah, I agree, actually. It's my favourite X-Men film, myself personally. I think it's really well cast. Like, it's got quite a large cast, but I think everyone is almost like perfectly suited to the role. Even like someone like out there like Kevin Bacon. I think Kevin Bacon wasn't the original choice, I believe. I think he kind of stepped in at the last minute, but
I don't know. I've done a lot of weeding on this. Do you know who the first choice was meant to have been?
No, I think I remember at the time. I remember reading Wikipedia. And,
I've got that page over open, so keep going. And if I happen across it, I'll let you know.
Yeah, I think mentioned Matthew Vaughn, like it was between him and Colin Firth. Now I don't know if Colin Firth actually accepted it, but I remember something being said at the time that he came in last minute to replace someone, but didn't mention who it was, who that was. Mm. So I was like, oh, okay.
Colin Firth was the joint sort of top choice, you like. Yeah.
But I don't know if he accepted it at all or anything like that. But I think he kind of nails the cut. I was trying to think who else could actually pull that off. Like this kind of like suave, like debonair, but highly evil like sort of person, like almost like Bond villain. But also have his little stint as like. As a mad German scientist, almost like it's like he pulls it off really well, yeah.
Well, I'm just looking through his filmography now because it's going to take me a minute. I mean, obviously, Hollow Man, he played a bad guy. But the film that springs to mind, I remember it when it came out, and I don't obviously when I get to the subject matter, it was never going to be a financial hit. Because it's a difficult subject matter, but he made a film called The Woodsman about 6 years before this. And he was like a child molester who's like back, sort of on parole. He comes out of prison. And I just think Kevin Bacon has that quality of being able to be whatever you want. You know, I can't think of his relative age now, but had he played like a Marty McFly, he could have done it. He can play a victim, though, hence something like Friday the 13th. He can play a good guy, like a Tremors, but he can also play like absolutely evil under the surface. And I think because of that sort of 6 degrees of separation game, he's almost become a bit of a punchline, and people forget what a quality actor he is.
Yeah,
Wild Things, you don't know him. Well, I think that's more the Matt Dillon character, but you don't know anyone's intentions in that film.
He is one of these actors who kind of you don't really realise because he does so many different things but isn't showy about it. So sometimes it can just see, oh, it's Kevin Bacon, oh, you know, he's in it because he's in so many films. He's worked probably with so many people. Like, you kind of like think, oh well, you know, you just think of Flashdance or whatever. But you know, but then when you stop and think about,
he's
like,
been a lot in a lot of films as well, like Mystic River and stuff like that, where co-stars have got all the attention, like a Sean Penn in that role. And when he's had
because he's not showy, though, is he? He's not like a, he's not someone to sort of.
Yeah.
Well, he probably to sort of like brag about it.
He may not have the same. I mean, Sean Penn's a particularly tough example to put yourself against because Sean Penn has so much screen presence. But yeah, I mean, he has been.
Sean Penn has been.
Yeah. I bet he could even get a 3 advert. But there's just something very stable about him. He's always been about as famous as always. Gets good supporting roles in a lot of things. I remember he was in Frost Nixon. He was very good in that. But again, not a lead. He's been famous for like 40 years plus. He's been married for 30 years plus. He's just the absolute picture of sort of stability. But then he comes into this film and it's again, it's quite a varied role. You see him, the first two scenes you see him in, he's totally different, isn't he?
Yeah. Yeah, he starts off at was one thing, and then he sort of reintroduces it as something else. But yeah, no, I think it's I like the look, I like the feel of it. I think it actually feels better than the previous X-Men films. I think it flows well. I think it's actually better written, and given the fact that this was all like done like in next to nothing time, like they literally just got this done, is quite impressive. And I think some of the faults are, if there are any issues, is largely down to like, well, they didn't have enough time for the effects, or
no, some of the effects looked very unfinished on the big screen. On the small screen, didn't look anywhere near as bad, even though it's in, you know, a high resolution. I was watching the 4K version, but there was one scene where the person watching it with me went, look at that, and pointed out something I've never noticed, and we'll get to it. And it's not an error, it's kind of a lazy effect that you don't notice until you notice, and then you go, oh yeah, okay. But it's not too bad. Becca?
Yes, so, yeah, I didn't really get a chance to say what my first impressions of this film actually were.
Yeah,
so,
do it
all together.
Sorry about that. It's probably me. You probably mentioned something else and I went on a tangent. Carry on.
No, that's okay. Should we do it to it and discuss the film in a sequential fashion?
No, you tell us your...
No, it's all right. Let's keep things moving along.
All right, no problem. We'll do it as we go into it then. I will ask one question, though, that I don't think we quite answered. Where were you with the X-Men series at this point? Were you looking forward to this?
I went to see it on the cast alone. I was blown away, and
right. So
then I was mildly interested in the previous film, and then it's a downhill trajectory from there.
It isn't it just okay? Let's discuss this film sequentially then. So the first scene isn't going to take very long to discuss at all because we did it about 4 weeks ago. The first scene is a direct recreation of the Auschwitz sequence from the start of the first film. There are two notable differences. The first notable difference is the colour palette. I've run them next to each other. I did it during the show. And this has a slightly warmer colour palette than the first versions. Warm is the wrong word. It is still Auschwitz. But it's got a browner tint. Where the original was very steel. So it's warmer. Right? Warm isn't a word you want to associate with where they are. But it is in keeping with the fact that where we're going is going to be much more colourful than that first film. The other difference is every time you get a close-up of the boy or his parents, obviously the actors change because they've got to go on and do another scene with that young boy. And the original boy will be now 10 years too old to do it. So the parents are swapped as well. I think that's probably because the mother has to be brought in a while. But every other shot is as from the first film, but just recolour timed.
Yeah, it's the same sequence, isn't it, pretty much, as I say.
But literally, they haven't recreated the shots. They've used the same shots.
Yeah, it's the same shot, but obviously just a little bit colour corrected. And
yeah.
So, but no, I think it's done really well, actually. It's done very stylishly. And I think it kind of has a bit more, I don't know, a bit more gravitas this time around. You know, obviously, it's very, very serious, and obviously how the scene develops as well. It's kind of done in a very, very sort of shocking way. and you know, it's really effectual. I think having Matthew Vaughn, you know, start, you know, work on this film just elevates it up to a whole new level. Obviously, we've seen him with the previous kind of action and superhero movies as well. But I think there are, you know, lots of clever flourishes here and there, especially with this scene, especially between the young Erik Lensherr and Kevin Bacon from the EE adverts. You know, it's done in, you know, a really kind of twisty-turny way that you didn't expect to see.
Well, yeah, he's taken up to see Kevin Bacon. There's two things I like about this. Firstly, it's shot Bacon on the right, Magneto as he's going to be, Erik Lensherr, the young boy, on the left, and we can see a window and everything else. But when we get the reverse shot, it's full of all this like torture equipment and stuff. And he's just trying to get the boy, speaking in German, to get the to move a coin he's got on the table. That coin will become a thing through the series.
See it later
through
on the film. Spoiler alert.
Absolutely. And he's just trying to get to move it. And again, this is quite instructive because there's a tragedy to Magneto. There always has been, but this film plays on it more. I don't think we'd ever had tears from the McKellen version. We do from the Fassbender version later in the film. But again, not hysterics, just an inner sadness, which is just kind of coming out in the form of some tears.
It's very sad.
But also, when you think he's going to go on to be the Malcolm X of this scenario, you can understand it, that if mutants have the ability to, and not only abilities, but can control those abilities, you should see that as a gift because he lost his mother because he couldn't control the ability.
Yeah.
His mother is shot because they think it's the tension and stress that's going to get him to move this, because he actually did all the damage outside in pain and stress. And of course, after she's shot, he's shrinking the helmets on the guards' heads and all that sort of thing and causing mayhem.
Yeah, you see everything sort of like crushing and all, like the filing cabinets are sort of smushed.
Yeah.
Yes, and Kevin Bacon's ecstatic.
He loves that. I love how much he's enjoying it. It's pretty good fun.
Yeah.
He's really good, though. I mean, obviously, you know, he's a legendary actor anyway, but he's really good in this. I kind of thought, I remember going to see it like first at the cinema, thinking, oh my god, it's just, he's going to be sort of really slimy and just, you know,
well, he comes
cringy,
off as,
but
yeah,
he
comes
fantastic.
Off as a total oddball here, and when you next see him, he's all Mr. Suave on his yacht.
Exactly, yeah, he's like, oh, Mr. Bond, I've been expecting you, and you just think, oh god. But actually, he's fantastic. You know, he's one of those. Yeah, he can do like all genres. You know, all sides.
Now I think we could be getting to Chris's first problem with the film. Part of me likes this. Firstly, I do wonder why Xavier maintains an English accent though. Because
I've got a comment about accents coming up at the end of the show, but there's just
child,
more accents to go in this movie.
Well, as a child, he's already in Westchester County, New York, in this mansion. He's obviously
quite, he's got a plumby English accent.
I know, he's distant from his parents because the reason he catches out his quote-unquote mother as not being his quote-unquote mother is the fact that she's friendly and warm and in the kitchen. His mother's there offering to make him a sandwich or whatever it is she offers him, and it turns out to be Raven, the woman we will come to know as Mystique, as a young girl, Raven Darkholm, and she's just looking for food, and then he sort of says, you know, you never be scared, need to be scared again, and she gets to stay and live there. Which makes me wonder where his actual parents are, that they're all right with this.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a bit creepy.
Who's any of the guardians are, or like, or
where did she come from? Like, what's going on?
Yeah.
I mean, if you had a child and you got home from work one day, and you're like 10-year-old kid and invited someone to come and live with you, you might have some opinion on it.
Yeah. You'd be like, I'm not too sure, you know, especially like. Plus, are they aware of this mutant thing as well? No. I mean, that's not really established. How do they feel about it? I mean, one of the things I did pick up on, like, sort of straight away was, like, the other bit, he's got a picture of Albert Einstein on his bedroom cabinet. It's almost like he's, like, that's his poster. That's his, like,
he's
you know,
my
like,
hero.
I thought, oh, come on, really?
I know, it makes me laugh when they're smart, they've got to have those sorts of things on the wall.
Yeah.
Whatever.
But yeah. But yeah, honestly, I don't I think accepting like as I know this is kind of like a this is a prequel, but also accepting like this is like also a different take on it. So,
yeah.
I think if you just like go right, well, okay, well, this is like not leading up to X-Men. This one, this is like a different interpretation.
It's fine. It's not a big deal, but obviously. I don't know how what the relationships were in the comic. We'd said this to start with. We're not readers of the comic. It would be quite easy to look it up, I suppose. But this whole brought up with Charles thing, that might be a retcon to bring it closer to the comics. It might be a retcon away from it, and we wouldn't know any different. But it doesn't fit with the first three films. But it's not a deal breaker. You know, Charles later on in life is going to be surrounded by people much younger than himself. And the only person he was friends with as a younger man is going to be distant. You need to give him other people to play off. And Mystique has not been explored. Well, I thought Rebecca Romijn played it absolutely perfectly. You didn't get under the skin much in terms of finding out much about her. So next we've got Bond audition take one.
Yeah, so this is like Eric sitting down playing with the coins. He's still got that coin that he couldn't move.
Yeah,
and it's like, you know, it's going in between his fingers and flick, and then like he moves it, basically sort of flicks it in straight into what's his name? His character,
Erik Lensherr.
Kevin Bacon's character.
Oh, Sebastian Shaw.
That's it. Yeah, he flicks in Sebastian Shaw's head, which will happen later on. Kind of like so,
but then he goes off to the bank.
Yes, got some gold
again. This has got Nazi overtones. Now, there's been, I don't know if they're rumors, conspiracy theories, or what you would call them, but it's long been sort of postulated that a lot of the senior Nazis like disappeared to South America after World War II, and I've always thought that was just like stories, so I don't know, but this film leans into it. So he goes to Switzerland, still talking German, and gets a banker to trace a bar of Nazi gold. And he does it by ripping the fillings out of his mouth. The first dodgy effect in the film, you've got a shot from inside the banker's mouth that looks awful.
I was going to say, there are a couple of shots, even though this was 2011, there's many thousands of visual effects. The majority of them do hold up really, really well. I think there's probably three, just in my opinion, three that perhaps don't really hold up, and this is one of them. But
yeah,
it's interesting though, isn't it? And it really kind of think, oh, you know, because I imagine that must be like a really painful experience as well.
Yeah.
You know, nobody likes to visit the dentist, I'm sure. Not a very pleasant experience. But yeah, it makes you feel like, looking at it from that point of view, it kind of rams at home a little bit, and you think, oh, you know, somebody literally ripping the fillings out of your face.
I've got to give, I have to give some credit to the sound design as well, the sort of creaking sound as it starts to come out.
Yeah, the crunch,
like,
oh my gosh.
It is. It would be nothing without its sound, and it's actually quite unsettling. But
everything like across the guy brings it home.
The guy in pain and terror names a very small village in Argentina. Although when he goes there, it looks a bit like The Sound of Music from outside.
Not Portugal, Argentina, I'm sorry.
It's Argentina.
Yes, I didn't know that, I just named the wrong country.
And I think I'm just going to mention a second lazy effect, and then we'll just talk about the scene as long as we want to. The backdrop of the bar, you can see out the windows and outside, and it looks like something out of the original series of Star Trek. It looks like a studio or something, or just like a blank, a sheet with some colouring on it. It's been draped. But apart from that, this is the scene that made every Bond fan look at Michael Fassbender, I think. Is that fair to say?
Yeah, that was like his audition, Bond audition number one, as you say.
I think it's just the way he carries himself.
It's the way he moves. And it helps he's in a 60s aesthetic. And even if Sean Connery was your least favourite Bond, right? To some degree, the Bond has always sort of stayed a 60s series in the heads of like a lot of the fans. That doesn't mean, I've said this before, I don't want them to make them set in the 60s. I don't. But there's something about the Bond series that will always evoke the 1960s in my head. It doesn't help they bring the DB5 back every 2 minutes as well. But I think because he's in a 60s aesthetic, it looks like modern and classic Bond, like meeting, and you go, that's perfect.
Smushed together and think, oh, that's what we want.
Yeah, basically, yeah, it turns out they're down there working as like a pig farmer and a tailor.
Yeah.
He's like, fancy that.
And they're just having a beer. And he just sort of chats to them. and it turns out that, you know, he says something about I don't have any parents. They were taken away by a pig farmer and a tailor.
Yeah.
And then I think he puts a knife through one of their hands, manipulates the metal of the barman stroke owner to shoot the other one.
Yeah. Then stabs the bar guy with the knife, then puts it back in his...
Yeah, flings it at him, draws it back.
And then, like...
Looks at a picture at the wall. And sees Sebastian Shaw sat in the middle.
Yeah.
Which I'm presuming is not the name he went by when he was a German, you know, killer or whatever, I don't know. So that's that. At the same... So we've now got them as young men. And as we go through this sort of... Let's just call it a reboot. The sort of 1960s crew. As we go through their years, their ages will not make any sense. Because we're in 1960 at 2. All right, Fassbender's 34. But given he's about the same age, let me think. He was a young boy at the end of World War II, which means he must be a little bit older than... Yeah, he must have been born in about, let's say, 1935. So he's late 20s here. At the same time, Xavier is probably mid-20s by the time he's done a doctorate. Mm. There's only a year or two between them. He's doing a thesis on mutation at Oxford University. Now, I suppose it's possible his entire schooling has taken place in this country. Maybe he just goes home at holiday times, I don't know.
Yeah.
Raven's with him as like a little sister, I suppose. And
yeah, he refers to her as his sister.
Yeah, and he's cracking on, and she's disguising her mutation. She looks like Jennifer Lawrence. Mm. And basically, Xavier spends all his time cracking onto women. Which is quite funny, because Patrick Stewart's character in Star Trek was fairly not asexual, but certainly sublimated that size of him to sort of focus on the job. And then you find out, as a young cadet, he was like a fighter and womanizer. So it's quite funny to see the same is sort of true here.
Yeah, I think there's always that dynamic of like, well, something in me kind of changed. I think it's that trope of like of you know, remembering someone else as a younger person, being completely different.
Yeah.
So you kind of have to, like, you go on a journey, you change yourself almost.
They've done it for years though, haven't they? I mean, yeah. look at Marty McFly's mother, puritanical in the present day and like all over the guys in the past.
Yeah.
Although a lot of that was just talk.
Yeah, there's probably like examples of villains as well. Like, you know, like, yeah, like when you look back of villains as a child, oh, they're ever such a good boy. Those kind of things.
Yeah, it's influenced by the Bond films anyway in look, and I think where else do we want to go in the plot here? So he's trying to crack onto women generally by talking about mutation. So he's talking to one woman who's got two eyes a different colour, and he's trying to use that to crack onto her. He'll later do that with the MacTaggert character. The MacTaggert character is in Las Vegas.
Yeah. She's investigating. Well, she's following one of the generals, isn't she? There's like the general like involved from the White House.
Yeah.
And he's going to, this potentially going to meet the Hellfire Club. And so she goes in, and she like sort of just goes in basically in an underwear.
Yeah.
This is kind of like at the time of the Cuban Missile Crisis, isn't it?
It is. I always get confused between that and the Bay of Pigs in terms of timing, but yeah. Mm.
So this is something to like, we don't know what the actual plan. There's something to do like maneuvering the, you know, warships or warheads. Is it warships or warheads?
What they're trying to, they're trying to get Aaron Pierce from 24, who used to look after the president, but he's now a big cheese in the forces and one of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, I'm assuming, without looking. He's a U.S. Army officer anyway, and they're trying to get, what they're trying to do is provoke a war because we will find out later that Shaw, they do it all through like mind reading, Shaw wants to hit the world with a ton of radiation and stuff because that's what causes mutations. So it will make them stronger and kill humans. So, not unlike Magneto's plot in the first film, it's like you mutate or die.
Yeah.
And that's the idea. So they're trying to influence him to vote for it, to send like a blockade out and get ready to attack, all this sort of thing. Well, first off, I think they're going to put them in Turkey. They're going to put missiles in Turkey. And again, this is what led into the Cuban Missile Crisis, because they retaliated by putting them in Cuba and so on. And much like the modern day discourse, both of these countries talk like they can do something that the other side can't do. We can have nuclear weapons, but you mustn't, that sort of thing. And obviously she sees mutation for the first time because she sees Emma Frost, January Jones's character, who basically, funny, she's called Emma Frost. January Jones has always had, apart from in American Wedding, she's always had kind of a cold screen presence, and I think that's deliberate. She's not entirely likable as a screen presence, although when she plays friendly, she is. But she basically is dressed in underwear, and she has mind-reading powers, and she can manipulate herself into diamond, so she can't be, and you can't read her thoughts at that point, and you can't hurt her really. You've got Azaziel there, which is Jason Fleming's character, and I believe he is a relative, he may be the father of, I'm not sure, Nightcrawler in the comics, and of course it's the same skill set, but one's red.
So I just say, I've seen this film many times, and I today realised it was Jason Fleming in the role. Oh,
yeah, I know. I was just like,
he's completely transformed himself.
Well, the first time I'm watching it, all the way through, going, I know him.
Who is it?
And I get towards the end of the film, and like one of the last time he appears, I went, hang on, Matthew Vaughn, lock, stock. Ah, got it. And I still couldn't
remember.
But then I could picture him, but not name him. So I still had to look it up when I came out. So, yeah, they teleport him there, convince him to change his mind, and then send him back to the president's war room, where he now supports missile placement in Turkey. So the whole thing is about manipulating forces to provoke a war.
Mm. And then she rings back base and said, I've just seen
Colonel
Aaron
Hendry.
Paul.
Yeah. Not Aaron Paul, that's Breaking Bad, Aaron Pierce.
Oh, God, Jesus Christ.
That's Aaron Paul, that's Jesse, bitch.
God, I'm just getting all the names wrong now, aren't I? Jesus Christ. Anyway, so she really like, well, I've seen him. He's in Vegas. She's like, well, no, he's just here.
Yeah.
He's in DC. I was like, well, that can't be right.
Yeah, and he is. And he's just there going, I've changed my mind. I'm voting for this now. Not very subtle, but fine. And then what? Colonel Hendry goes to meet him on his boat and pulls a grenade on him, and we find Shaw can absorb energy and then reuse it. We'll see similar mutations. Well, I suppose it's not unlike Gambit, but it's a lot more powerful, and it's what's keeping him young. It's why he's not aged in nearly two decades. So Hendry is now killed by him, and MacTaggert heads to Oxford to see Xavier, who's a little bit drunk.
Yeah, so he's on the pull again. She asks for help, and he says, okay, I'll see what I can do.
It's when he reads her mind. He's less subtle than the Patrick Stewart version. He literally puts his fingers to his temple when he's doing something like that. And I don't mind. It's quite a nice little quirk, but it is different. Of course, he sat like he's just thinking, but he reads her mind.
He's younger as well, so you're thinking like, well, obviously as he gets older, he develops it more.
Of course, so he may not need to do that. But he reads her mind and he sees some of what she saw with Azaziel and Emma Frost and all the rest of it. Because she's asking about mutation, and he just says, something tells me you've seen something like this. And when he realises how serious it is, they head into Langley together.
Yes, and so he gives his presentation. And they all just think, well, that's a load of bollocks.
Yeah. Well, you would have to prove it, wouldn't you? But thankfully, Mystique's there. So, not yet Mystique, but she's there. And she changes a few times and everything else. So, they get it. and I don't even know if the character's got a name. But
so, yeah, so they're going
Oliver
like,
Platt.
Yeah, they're going to lock him up then, or send him some of Oliver Platt. So no, I'll use him. Now he turns out to be someone who has always believed this sort of stuff.
Yeah, and never had any proof.
Yeah, and so he's got his own little sort of facility, and it's from there we meet Hank. And I like his introduction because, like, Charles
walks in and went, "Oh, look, a mutant!"
Yeah, pretty much.
And he's not out as a mutant again. Back to those sort of coming out.
Yeah.
You know, particularly with the guy's age, you know, late teens or whatever he might be at this point. And he's just a scientist working for him, but an absolute genius. He's sort of Tony Stark level. Mm. And it turns out he's really apologetic because Charles is a nice man. "I'm so sorry, I didn't realise they didn't know." So he shows his mutation, which at this point is kind of like simian type fate, I suppose.
Yeah. I mean, say it's like super intelligence.
Super intelligence is part of it.
Yeah.
That would have to be a mutation. There's very few people in history that smart. And he could do everything and learn everything. So that's part of it. Part of it is agility and strength. But he looks perfectly normal at this stage. We'll come to that.
His feet.
And then what? Well, yeah, but he can make his feet look normal. And right, he can put them into shoes. Put it that way.
Yeah.
He can hide it. Now, when does Lensherr come into this? Oh, they've built a prototype of Magneto, haven't they?
Yeah, they got
not a prototype of Magneto. That's not even a fucking word. What was the word I was thinking of? A prototype of what's that thing?
So Cerebro.
Cerebro. I've named it once tonight already.
Yeah.
All right. So they're
all getting names wrong.
They're able to find where Shaw is.
Yes. But Shaw has his own Magneto helmet.
He does. Probably not called a Magneto helmet at this point.
Yeah.
But yeah, Magneto attacks him. Magneto goes there because he's on the hunt as well. And he's been told by those guys he killed where Shaw is. And he has...
he tries to leave, doesn't he, Erik? He tries to, like... It's like, no, this kind of, like, you know, teamwork isn't for me.
Well, first off, he tries to kill him. Then he tries to stop the boat getting away. And eventually...
Oh, sorry. Sorry, we're jumping ahead here.
No. At this point, he's found by... He knows there's a mutant there. He knows two things. He knows that Emma Frost is there, not by name, but someone like me, because I'm being blocked. Mm. And he said, "I can feel another mutant." And he looks in the water, and it's Erik. And he kind of saves Erik, because Erik is so obsessed, he's going to drown trying to stop this thing. They get him aboard. Yeah. He calms him down. And they get him back to the facility again. And then we are on to using this Cerebro to locate mutants and recruit them.
Yes, and this is where we get the sequence of meeting all the first class.
Yeah, so who's in this class? We've got Banshee. Well, I'm talking of the names they'll come to take. One of the few clunky names scenes in the film where they choose their names. It's really cheesy. But so going by their names, you've got Banshee and Havoc. So Havoc is another Summers. It ain't Scott Summers, I can't remember. Alex Summers. It's basically his... I believe it's going to be like his older brother, yeah. Watch how he does or doesn't age as we go through this series, because by Apocalypse he's meant to be about 38 and he looks like 21, you know. It's really silly, and when Erik is meant to be like 60 odd and his son, it just none of it makes sense. But at this stage they're kind of teenagers. Havoc has a similar ability, but it isn't focused on the eyes. It is all to do with rays and stuff like that, and they're going to work to focus that. Banshee has like a supersonic noise that he can break things with, but also fly with it, because he can use it, the frequency against the ground. You've got what will become Angel, which is the Zoe Kravitz character, who's basically working as a stripper, I suppose, or lap dancer. And she goes in to dance for them, and she's like, "We know what you are." They show them his ability with metal, and she takes off her top and actually spreads wings so she can fly. You probably get to see her tits as well, but that's unconfirmed. And then who else? What's the guy who absorbs all the powers?
Oh, yeah.
The cab driver.
Oh, yes. Oh, it's...
I'm just looking for it. Darwin.
Darwin, yeah.
Yeah, reactive evolution, he calls it. Basically, he adapts to survive. So if he sticks his head in water, he'll grow gills, like, immediately. If he needs to, you know, turn into concrete, he can. And I think that's most of them. Obviously, Hank, we've already mentioned. And that's it. So the other thing is, of course, they do go in to see Logan, not named, sat at a bar. Hi, we're here to see, go fuck yourself. And then they just leave him.
Yeah.
I wish they'd learnt from this, though, because they cram Logan in. I mean, Logan has some great stuff still to come. I remember liking the next film. I remember liking Logan itself. But my favourite of the film so far barely has any Wolverine in it. And then I look at, like, Apocalypse, where they crammed him in where he didn't need to be. And I'm just wishing they'd had a bit more confidence.
Well, yeah.
So they're all recruited. They sit around and show each other their abilities. They give themselves these names, which is, I suppose, they are kids by and large, except the taxi driver.
He's probably young as well, isn't he?
They're just training to try and control their abilities.
Yeah, it's largely done as, why are you here?
It's a very 60s style montage. The music is very 60s, and it's very sort of upbeat. So he's trying to get Hank to embrace his mutation and spread his feet and actually run properly, and so because they're running at the same speed before that, he's trying to get Banshee to be able to fly.
This afterwards is at the Xavier Palace. We're still at the FBI place.
Go on. This is before they go back.
So this is the round table where they're just basically sort of spitting, like, you know, getting to know each other kind of thing, and that's when they sort of like go, oh, I'm gonna have this name and that name, and they're all like kind of pissed. And when Charles and Erik and MacTaggert arrived, they were all like pissing around and like not impressed.
I like and dislike this. I like it because we need reminding their kids. They do need schooling. They do need guidance. It's not just a question of like finding them on the streets and you're away. I like it, but I find the scene where they're all cheesily giving each other their names really clunky.
It's also because Mystique is actually finally like letting loose almost, because I mean, only having to sort of like, you know, being around Charles.
Yeah, but it's Erik is trying to get her to be her.
Yeah. But she's like, oh, finally I can like, you know, break loose with like new people kind of thing. So there's that. And then where do we go from there? We go on a mission on in Russian, don't we? Or like a Russian base.
Go on, I'm not sure. I thought the attack was around here. I thought they barely got through that bit.
No. So that's they stay behind, but obviously Charles, Erik, and Rose McGowan's character. I think maybe Beast as well goes with them as well.
They do go to Russia. Shaw's not there. They go there to get Shaw, but Shaw's not there, which they can work out. And Charles is like, I can feel her, so she'll know I'm here. He sends Frost instead, and it's to talk to this. It's to talk to the villain from Taken 2 and the guy who Batman said nice coat to.
Basically, like Hollywood's favorite Russian.
Yeah, Russian or Bulgarian or whatever, because the West can't really tell the difference anyway.
He's just got such a good look. He just has that like look that just says Russian. That's the thing.
He does.
He's just got such a good.
It works to sort of what we know anyway. I love the fact she tries to charm him into whatever she wants, but she can put images in your mind. So he thinks he's like getting fruity on the bed with her, and she's just sat off at the side going pathetic. And I like that.
And you see him, he's there like, you know, on his own. Like,
I did get Living Daylights vibes there. Don't know about you, Becca, but the bit where at the start where he's like got his head in her boobs and he's reacting like no man actually reacts in real life, as far as I can imagine.
Cake, boshed.
What do you reckon, Becca?
Yeah, I would agree. It is a little bit like that scene, unfortunately. Yeah, getting the same vibes for sure.
It's got a good balance of humour, though, because, I mean, it doesn't, with what's coming with Erik and the tears and everything, it all still works.
No, so it works really well. And I would agree that I don't know the actor's name, but he does pop up as, like, your token Russian or token Eastern European.
I don't know how to pronounce it. It's René something.
He plays a similar sort of role in all those sort of films, but I know who you mean, but yeah, I can't remember the actor's name, unfortunately, but he does seem to play those kind of, you know, token roles in movies. But he's very good, very, you know, he does very well in it, and he's known for that sort of part. But yeah, I'm just kind of like, hey, it's that guy who's played every other Russian character.
So I think the bottom line is here, they find out where Shaw is and get a bit more out of the plan because they get hold of January Jones and basically tie her to the bed. Not quite as sexy as it sounds, but basically Magneto is just pushes her further and further until she has to give the information. And then she's then in custody until late in the film. Anything else at this point?
Yeah. Yeah, so she's kind of out of the picture to a degree, while Sebastian Shaw actually goes to the FBI base. But it is quite an impressive and brutal attack at the same time, because you've got Azrael just literally just teleporting people in midair and just dropping them.
Yeah.
And this, it's just like...
This is a marvel of tone, this film, because... We talk about tonally unsettled and confused films where it's funny one minute and brutal the next. This film manages it. None of this is upsetting or troubling, but like it feels like it has stakes. So I'm really happy with it.
I think it's almost like the you kind of got like the bounce of like sort of bouncy, kind of happy, and then there's also when shit gets real, so to speak. It's like, oh yeah, so. Yeah, so we see Oliver Platt's character. He gets unceremoniously killed, which I think to films testament, you kind of do feel bad for him. You do feel like, oh, that's...
Yeah. Bear in mind, this character does not have a name. So no. Well done, yeah.
you're kind of thinking, oh, I was kind of hoping he'd be in the film more.
Always liked Oliver Platt anyway.
Yeah,
he was in a really bad film. Well, I say a really bad film. It was charming in its way, but it sunk without trace. He was in a film with Matthew Perry and Neve Campbell called Three to Tango years ago, which isn't what the name suggests. But he's a character in that, and that was the first time he's ever on my radar. And then the last thing I think I saw him in, because I often get him confused with Patton Oswalt, although they're completely different sizes and don't look that similar.
Oliver Platt's deceptively tall as well.
He is very tall, yeah, whereas Patton Oswalt's quite small, but I think maybe they're similar ages, I don't know. He was the film critic in Chef that really pissed off Jon Favreau and ends up giving him a job near the end of the film. Fantastic, that film, I love it.
Yeah, so it's just a bit, they kill everyone, essentially, and then try and recruit the mutants themselves. And so Zoe Kravitz's character decides to join.
Yeah, then, I think I saw that coming. I don't know what it is about the character, but there was just something that... I think there's a slight Hollywood puritanical to it, actually. I think it might be the fact that they found her in a bit of a sleazy sort of strip club, and it's like... The film inherently always seems to... Films always inherently seem to punish people for those sorts of choices. Maybe I'm overthinking
I think because it was set... Because it was like... Fairman had a conversation, you know, when they were all like palling around. It was like, oh, we shouldn't have to hide, kind of thing, you know. That's very much like what Raven's about, and she's very much on that sort of side. So you kind of sort of, it's kind of like insinuated like that's where things fall with her. So it is a bit stunning, it's a bit rushed. There are things in this film that does feel a bit rushed. And that might be one of them, because we've only just met her anyway, so you probably get away with it.
Could be.
But yeah, she does insinuate that sort of sense of, like, we shouldn't change, like, that kind of thing. I forget exactly what it was, but yeah. So she joins Darwin and... is it Alex? They hatch a plan to... kind of stop him,
yeah,
but it doesn't work out.
It doesn't work. It's to do with like blasting the window and then it's get out the way and they're going to fire and it's absorbed quite easily and then just pushed into Darwin and Darwin is killed. That's the basics of it anyway.
Yeah. Which is another character you think, oh, I quite like that. That seemed like you could do something with that character.
Well, I mean, I don't mind the film having like a younger cast. I don't need to see myself represented in this, and I was a bit younger when it came out anyway. But there is something about the fact that he was visibly older that I just thought gave the film a little bit of balance. But I've no problem. It's one of those things, and it always helps to kill somebody off just to give the rest of it stakes. So no big deal, honestly.
And then this is where they obviously everything's just like destroyed. And this is where they go to like Xavier's Xavier's like mansion essentially, which turns out to be the school.
Well, yeah, because they're not safe there, so they're finally seeing the school. Sorry, I've caught up with where I was, where we were talking earlier.
Yeah.
Then we get some training because it's like a Rocky film. They're training for like the rematch. Yeah. Do you know what I mean? Not as literal as that.
You got the balance with the you got the stuff with Raven because we not mentioned like there's romantic feelings between Beast and Raven. Which you know Raven seems to be like you know got the hots for you know Charles or like feeling kind of rejected by Charles.
No, I don't think that's romantic.
Instantly gets crushed on the Beast, and then starts getting hit on Michael Fassbender. So, bit all over the place there, but yeah, there's the Fairy leans heavily with Beast, and Beast kind of like makes the mistake of wanting to kind of like no, we want to look normal, even though
well, he's trying to convince himself. Magneto's been trying to convince Mystique that she's beautiful in her normal form, that mutation is inherently beautiful, and that hiding her mutation or concentrating on hiding her mutation actually makes her weaker, and he proves that with a set of weights and stuff. So she's slowly being coaxed into thinking mutation is right, they shouldn't be hiding. Charles has always been about integration and fitting in. It's not necessarily even being embarrassed by your mutation. But of course, we're also at a point where this is a weakness for Charles in some respects, that his mutation is not visible. So it's very difficult for him to get through to Raven because it's like, well, it's fine for you. Look at me. I'm blue. She even walks into him in her normal form without any clothing on because she's always worn clothing around him. And he's like, you're naked. Yeah. Which
and
is...
He's always danced around the questions like, would you find me attractive?
Right, as I am,
and he's like,
really. And yeah. I tend to think by implication the answer is no, but at the same time it's not as simple as that because, he's right. He can't think of her that way. You know.
Yeah. He's deflecting with something that's true, but while knowing.
But that's not what she needs to hear. But he can't honestly say to his younger sister, yes, theoretically, I would find you sexually attractive. Mm. So you can see both sides. Absolutely. Yeah. Right, let's spin on a bit. Where do we go from there? With loads of training sequences we don't have to say much about. There's a bit of humour in it. So you've got Havoc trying to control the blasts down in what will become the X-Tunnel that will lead to Cerebro at some point, but it's undeveloped at this point. So lots of humour with him trying to shoot mannequins and all the rest of it. You've got Banshee trying to jump out a window and actually just landing painfully. You've got Beast learning to run. And then I think you've also got side bits where Raven and Beast, Hank, are talking, you know, and having almost a romantic connection. But of course, Hank's now at the point that he wants his mutation gone. So he's developed vaccines for both of them.
Yeah, which is kind of Hank basically unleashing his insecurities onto her.
Yeah, the trouble is it almost pushes her the other way. She nearly takes it.
Yeah.
But then, of course, you've got the sort of faux romantic scene with Magneto when she's in the bed and actually he says you're too young and she changes into Rebecca Romijn. Hank takes it, and initially his feet go back to normal, but then they just blow absolutely over and the top, and he turns into Beast as we know, but even more feral looking than the Kelsey Grammer version.
Yeah, he doesn't quite look right to me.
No, he doesn't.
But then...
He doesn't.
But then, he is younger, I get, you know, so you do have that, but again... It's rush special effects as well.
And they're going to take off and head towards the Caribbean, to Cuba, where all this is... They know this is going to happen.
Yeah.
Hank is, like, told, you know, mutant and proud, and he's embarrassed coming in to see everybody. But he flies the craft. He's one of the team. We get TV broadcasts of the time, the blockade of the Russian fleet from President Kennedy.
Yeah.
Shaw is travelling with the Russian fleet to ensure the missiles get there, and they're flying there to stop the fleet's engaging, and they're going to engage at the point that the barrier is broken, which it is going to be, because the crew have been killed and Azaziel's actually doing it.
So, yeah, so you got Michael Ironside as the American captain, and so they're like about to fire on the ship. Because it's about to break, but then Charles manages to tap into one of the crew of the Russian side, so they essentially blow their own ship.
Yeah, exactly. Which does buy them time, because it's totally like they're now like, what does that mean? Is that a rogue ship, or you know, that they've even tried to stop war? I don't know what else I want to say about this whole sequence. The third act of the film does hold me, and third acts don't always. I'm interested in all of this, but I don't really know how much to say about it.
Sebastian Shaw goes, right, fine, well, I have to do it myself, kind of thing, because he's in a submarine. Mm. They're trying to find him, so they use Banshee to locate him.
With sonar, yeah.
Sonar. While Shaw's there, like absorbing like the nuclear energy in his sub, thereby he's gonna sort of basically sort of like detonate it himself.
Yeah.
Or use it. So they're trying to like sort of stop Shaw's. Mm. Shaw's like got helm inside this nuclear thing, which Charles can't get to.
Well, he can't get into that room, and he can't get past the helmet anyway. It's a double whammy.
Yes. So when Magneto, when they get the submarine onto shore, Magneto manages to get in. Like by this point, everyone's having a fight. Magneto sort of goes into the room with Shaw, and Shaw, they have a conflict, almost like Shaw's trying to get him to join.
Yeah, definitely.
But then.
Yeah, this is Magneto. Where he drags it onto the beach, doesn't he?
Yeah.
They locate it, and Magneto with his powers can drag that onto the beach.
So Magneto, they're like sort of destroying the casing. It's kind of got like a, don't know, it's a glass sort of.
It is. It's like casing. It's like a mirrored room.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so Charles can now see into there now through Erik. Obviously can't tap into Shaw to stop him.
Yeah.
So Erik manages to get the helmet off by sneaking one of the metal wires, taking his helmet, and then that makes Charles able to sort of freeze him.
Yeah, freeze him in place.
I thought this is quite a really good fitting end for Shaw, because. Well, now Magneto is in control. He puts the helmet on, so he knows it kind of puts Charles in stone, because he can't let Shaw go. Now he's got him.
He can't let him go, and he can't stop him either. And he's in his head, so he will, to some degree, feel the pain.
Yeah, and so he can't like stop. So he can't let Shaw go, and he can't stop Erik. And Erik is just does the whole.
So he has to hold Shaw in place for Erik to do that.
And like so he says, I agree with everything, every word you say. However. You kill my brother, so I'm going to move the coin. And basically does the same, like, echoes the same what happened at the beginning of the film.
Yeah, he smashed it into the middle of his forehead, but it was a picture. Now he does it to the real one.
And he's sort of, like, throwing to the coin as, like, I'm going to move the coin for you. And it's just, like, I think it's almost, like, poetic, almost.
Yeah.
But,
And then we move on to the beach itself, because Erik wants revenge. In fact, all the fleets then aim at the mutants. And Erik stops all of that and turns it on them. So you've got MacTaggert trying to sort of get the army to call off, or the navy, and they won't. You've got Charles desperate to sort of get into Lensherr's head to stop it. You've got MacTaggert eventually tries to shoot at Erik to stop him, and he deflects one into Charles's back, which is where the paralysis comes from. How do they stop him in the end, though? I think he is distracted long enough, isn't he?
Yeah. Yeah,
they blow up in the air.
Essentially, when it comes down to it, they manage to sort of, and then sort of send to Charles, and they.
I think it's the bullet. I think it's the bullet actually does that. Yeah. You know, he's already being distracted by MacTaggert, but there's still a few, and then he accidentally catches. Yeah. And then he starts to choke Moira for it, and Xavier. Says, you know, it's not her fault, and he releases, and then he takes off with his new first class, if you like, which is Mystique goes with him, as does Angel, Azazel, and the other guy we've not mentioned. He's known as Riptide, but it's kind of a little bit like Storm, but he can do sort of typhoons with his hands, more or less.
But he doesn't have a line of dialogue, though. So
doesn't have a line of dialogue. Mentioned. He just stands there, you know.
It's just like a heavy, but anyway, so they go off. Charles can't feel his legs, and then next scene you have he's pretty much in the
basically from the neck down he's cosplaying as Patrick Stewart. Yeah,
and this is one of the like probably one of my main gripes of how I feel like the film's got rushed a bit. It felt like you set up like a potential. A prequel story, like years is away, and we're ending pretty much where everyone's in their place. You can literally start the next.
But the other thing is, when we get to X-Men First Days of Future Past, he's in a different place. It's like you got him to be Patrick Stewart but younger and with hair, and by the next film he's moved a million miles away from it. So it's a little bit. But again, it's different creative teams because it's going to be Brian Singer next time again.
I have issues with the creative decision in terms of like his disability, shall we say.
Well, so do I, because it undermines even X3. It undermines all of it. In fact, this film does as well, and I haven't mentioned it. I mean, the whole vaccine stroke cure, all right, it didn't work properly, so maybe you can say it took decades to perfect afterwards, but... It's a bit regressive to have any version of a vaccine at this stage when it's 40 years before there's going to be one out there.
Maybe that was Vaughn's way of like of tagging in, like, well, that was my idea in X-Men 3.
Okay, possibly.
Maybe.
But the point is, the second film doesn't follow on of a piece from this. The constant jumps in time we get after this are a terrible idea. I do quite like Days of Future Past, by the way. But all the things with the original crew being back make no sense and are not explained to us. That we've always had that it's the near future. We're given a year the next time, and that makes no sense because it's about 10 years ahead of when the film was made. And then we go back into the past to find a Charles that bears no relation to this Charles. And just beast with him, and there's things I like about it, and there's things I like about the portrayal and style, but at this point I just wish there'd been I wasn't disappointed at the time because I'm a Superman fan, but in hindsight I'm disappointed Singer left when he did and didn't get to at least finish the third one. But by the time I walked out of Days of Future Past, I was thinking a similar idea but Matthew Vaughn, and I think that might have been a little bit better. But there you go. That's the end of the film, really. Except that Magneto breaks out Emma Frost and says, "Call me Magneto."
In full Magneto retire as well.
In full Magneto retire. He's even had a respray on the helmet.
Yeah.
The one on his head. So that's all I want to say. This is my favourite X-Men film, and I think I don't have a lot more to add than that. I think it's my favourite X-Men film to date. I will give Logan Days of Future Past, of the ones that are left, certainly a fair chance to prove that wrong. I'd be surprised if Days of Future Past did, but there are people with opinions I respect who put it absolutely top tier, and I think it's only a few little gripes and complaints that I don't. I mean, if I've got a top three and they're the elite, like Days of Future Past is like fourth, you know, it's really close to that top tier for me. So let's see on a review. Logan is top tier, but I remember not liking the third act. I basically don't like anything after he leaves Dr. Benton and family. So we'll see on that. But as we stand, this is the most internally coherent film. It balances the tone better than any of the other films. It's got some colour in it without being cartoonish, whereas the first ones now have dated because they're so grey. The cast have not fallen into doing impressions. They've just committed to doing this film. It's very well cast, very well directed. The third act has very, very good action, given, you know, it's not really my thing and not my favourite part of the film by any means. It's got that lovely 60s aesthetic that tends to work when you modernize it a little bit. Is it the greatest superhero film of all time? No, I think there's a good few that are better, but it's really, really solid, and it probably reflects, ironically, with no Hugh Jackman, who's probably the best thing in the whole series, but with no Hugh Jackman, they've produced probably the best X-Men film. That's all I want to say.
Yeah, I really enjoyed this film. I went into it, to be honest, after the last previous X-Men movies. My expectations were low, but upon release I went to see this film mainly because of the cast. I was blown away. Matthew Vaughn does an excellent job. All the cast are on top form. There are some iffy moments, and especially watching this now 10 years on, some of the effects don't hold up, but largely, as I say, it does really well. As Dave, as you said, it balances tone. It does play a bit wibbly wobbly timey wimey with it, to quote from another series, with the timeline, but you know, this story is all over the place anyway, to be honest. But I really enjoyed it, and for me, I think along with the original trilogy, and Logan, and possibly the next film that we've got coming up, this is probably one of the top films of the series. And hopefully, you know, after the last film in the series, which is a real clunker for me, it can go anywhere but up.
Yeah, I agree. This is probably my favourite X-Men movie. I think it's really well cast, as I said before. The only main issues is largely down to just how, by the time we get to the end, everything just feels like we could just, you know, launch into like the regular X-Men films. Where
you could just literally say 30 years later and just carry on.
Yeah, it's, you know, we're thinking like, you know, you've got, you know, 30, 40 years before all that stuff happens.
And you've left very little room for development, except for subsequent films retcon it a bit.
I mean, yeah. I mean, like, look, you can kind of say, okay, you know, there may or may not be a sequel at this point, but you kind of not left any room to breathe, and I found it a bit unnecessary, particularly as, like, Xavier's chair is literally just rolled off the one that he has had in the
modern
one.
It is the same one, although in the next film he'll have a really, like, modern one, but yeah.
Yeah, but it's the 60s, you wouldn't have that. So that always bothered me at the time. I thought, come off it. But, you know, it flows really well. It's really well handled. It's funny, but also knows when to pack a punch as well. So yeah, I think it's probably my favorite one. I enjoy most of the performances. So yeah.
Okay, cool. We're going to sign off fairly quickly tonight, because we'll be honest, listeners, we're recording this in the middle of a heat wave, sat next to computers, all three of us, that are kicking off insane heat, and we're all struggling. So we've got that out as best we can. As for the social media...
Yes, we can barely remember names.
We can barely remember names, and frankly, you know, we're going off on tangents and stuff, which never happens. So... as for social media, you can find me at ThePastyKid1976 on Twitter.
You can find me at Cinematronics. You can find me all the old podcasts at Cinematronics.co.uk.
And you can find us on Twitter at ExpectUsToTalk. Talk on Facebook.com, also YouTube, Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, Spotify, Podbean, and Podbay.
Great. So, I think it's time we went to Japan, which means Becca.
Do you expect to talk or return with the Wolverine?